Hi, I'm Jack Martin. I'm standing here on my property in Tubbs Lane in Calistoga. I'm here with Wes Miller, Mike's old business partner and close friend. And Wes has asked me to tell the story of the evening that Mike decided to leave us. So that's what I'm going to do for you here. You just saw my garden. I'm on about a 2.5 acre property here in Calistoga. I got the email that's now a matter of public record from Mike at about 7:45 asking me to come back to the property, that it was urgent, and that I should bring the sheriff. I didn't get the significance of what he was asking me, but I came out here in a hurry. Came down my long driveway. It was already dark. It was about 8:30, 8:40. And this is my Chevrolet pickup truck over here. So I came down the driveway in my old Chevy. And as I turned the corner here, in my headlights, I headed over to the blue and white GMC that Mike had mentioned in his email. And there on the ground in front of the blue GMC, I saw a body. And to tell you the truth, my first thought was not that it was Mike. My first thought was that perhaps Mike had gotten in a confrontation with somebody. Mike had been on my property since late February, staying in a nice old Spartan travel trailer there. So this was Mike's trailer in the back. This is Mike's old Lincoln that he came out from Colorado and struggled his way down the mountain in dramatic fashion till he finally came smoking and screaming and huffing and puffing into the driveway in late February. So we put him in here. So that night, the first thing I did was come to the trailer and come look for Mike. The notes that are also a matter of public record, the photos are out there. They were taped here on the outside of the trailer. I didn't see them that night. I was just worried about Mike. I came here, I walked into the trailer, called Mike's name. At that point, the note he had requested that I call the sheriff before I come, I did not call the sheriff until I saw the body on the ground, and then I got the sheriff on the phone. So I was still here alone, walked into the trailer, called Mike on the phone with 911. That was when I realized the trailer was empty and I saw that Mike had laid out a couple of notes and a few personal effects.
So you did not approach the body that you saw? You came over
I
here
did for... not at okay. first.
Okay.
I began to realize what had happened. The 911 operator said, "Mr. Martin, get out of the trailer. Don't touch anything." At that point, they were concerned for my safety, because they didn't really know what had happened. So I came back out, I did what they said, closed up the trailer, we're not in the city limits of Calistoga here, but the Calistoga police were closer than the sheriff, so the first people to arrive on the scene were a couple of Calistoga officers who were known to me personally. I've been living here about 20 years, 25 years. But all they knew in their first summation of the scene was that there was a body down and it looked like there had been shots fired. So they approached me with great caution, being the terrifying individual that I am, not to be trusted any further than I can be thrown. and they had me just stand over here while they looked around. It was all by flashlight. It was sort of an eerie scene. I'm actually wearing one of Mike's shirts now. Mike was on the ground. He was in denim. I did, while I was on the phone with 911, I approached the body and the operator said to me, "Would you like to attempt CPR? And I said, "No, I don't think so." because I could tell from his position and his stillness that I knew he knew what he was doing, and he had done a very clean and permanent job of it, so there was really no point doing CPR. So this is the blue and white GMC over here that he referred to in the email. And at that point, I walked over here, and Mike's body was on the ground, about 20 feet in front of the GMC. And I was still a little distant. I looked, it looked to me like it was very likely Mike, but I just, I did what the police told me. I stepped away from the body, I stepped away from the trailer. I waited for the authorities to get here. So the Calistoga police were here. Took about 10, 15 minutes after that. So let's see, if I arrived here, I get the timing. I learned about the timing subsequently myself. The 911 call, the time of record of the 911 call was 8:49. I had received the email at 7:45. I believe that I was here by about 8:35, 8:40. It took me that long to come in and then pick up the phone. So 8:49, I'm on the phone with the sheriff. I'd say the Calistoga police got here within 5-10 minutes. Must have been another 15 minutes after that that the sheriff showed up. So at that point, there were enough officers for them to keep an eye on me and assess the situation. The Calistoga officers were mostly, one of them had me over there and one of them was looking around. Sheriff came, did his preliminary look, confirmed that there was a body on the ground and a gun fired, called the coroner and the investigator from the sheriff's office. Took them, Napa's about 25 miles away. I'd say it took them about 45 minutes to get here. So I was with the first sheriff, Bill, don't remember his last name. Everyone was very courteous, everyone was very respectful, everyone was compassionate. And then it became kind of a scene. Bunch of sheriffs, bunch of flashlights, couple of fire engines out front, life support. They wound up turning around in a few minutes and leaving once they had confirmed what had happened. The investigators were very thorough. For those of you who are watching this, I will tell you that I have given no small amount of thought to different scenarios about what might have taken place. And I am firmly of the belief that Mr. Ruppert had decided that he had fulfilled his earthly purpose and had reached the end of his road. I had seen him earlier that afternoon. And he had also seen another young friend of mine on the property and had made comments to people that led people to scratch their heads about what he was talking about. But it later became clear that he had already decided by Sunday afternoon at the latest that he was going to do this. He wrote his notes, he prepared everything meticulously. There were two notes in the trailer. One was to me, one was to Jesse Ray. They were in different handwriting. One was in her note, the note to her was in cursive. The note to me, I asked the sheriff what they thought about that, and it was in block print. And they said that it was apparent that they knew he was ex-law enforcement because it was police block print. The police are all, they're all taught in police academy to write their notes in such a manner that they can be easily read by anybody. And it was his intent with that note that he wrote to me, both to be clear to me, to be clear to the police. And I also realized that the way he had composed it, he knew that it would become a matter of public record. And so it was his desire that his intent would be clearly interpreted. And it was. So this was where Mike spent. You know, you could see if you go back and look at his Facebook profile picture, the last one, that he was standing out here. We're in the middle of the, we're at the north end of the Napa Valley. And he was here, for 4 or 5 weeks in relatively cramped quarters, but he had been pressed to leave Colorado, sent an email blast out. I had known him for a few years at that point and welcomed him and said, you know, I had a place for him to stay. So he came here. He was comfortable. Rags was here. They would, poor bastard, still smoke cigarettes like it was going out of style. But he didn't leave any cigarette butts. He was respectful of me and my property. And I said, look, I don't care how many cigarettes you smoke and what you do to yourself, but don't be soiling my property. And he was good about that. But he really enjoyed the mountains. It was peaceful for him here. He enjoyed the garden. My children are here working the garden. He enjoyed, he had said that he felt that his path was no longer the path of a warrior, that what he had learned from his spiritual leaders up in the mountains, that it was now his purpose to be a teacher. So he came down here and he taught and spent time with the young people and spent time with me. And as he did all his life, he expressed himself very freely and emphatically about what he believed and thought was going on. So he was comfortable here. Spiritually, he was comfortable here. And obviously, he was comfortable enough. I realize now in retrospect, that along with so many other things, that this was a place that he was comfortable enough, that this was where he chose to make his departure, to make his transition from the physical world to the spiritual world. A lot of people have said things to me like, oh, it's unfair, how could he do that to you, so on and so forth. It was not unfair. It was not a burden. It was kind of an honor that Mike, who had influenced me like he had influenced so many others and taught us so much about the realities of the world we live in and the realities of the forces, both the physical forces and the intellectual and financial forces that have all our balls in a vice. And he had shaped the path that I had chosen. And it was an honor for me that he trusted me to find his body, to care for his body, to care for his dog, to care for his beloved, to care for his belongings. And now, with the help of his good friend Wes Miller, to care for all you as I can, just by sharing the story of his last night and his last days. So actually, let's come back over here.
Okay.
There were notes to me, there were notes to Jesse Ray. This is, as I said, Mike's old Lincoln. He had put Rags in the car. And I knew when I got here, I knew that I would find Rags in the car as I did. There was a note in the car. For all those of you who knew Rags through Mike's writings and Mike's videos, and there are many of you who are concerned about Rags, and as we have all pieced it together, Rags came all the way from Colorado with Mike in this car. Mike had a big stinky dog bed in the front seat of this Lincoln, and it was him and Rags coming all the way down the mountain. The crazy bastard, he called me like every few hours telling me where he was and what was going on. So he put Rags in this car, and I know that his last bit of business on this earth in his physical incarnation, he was here with Rags telling Rags what was going on. I can only surmise that he asked Rags' permission to leave. So I found Rags sitting in the car. I think that Rags heard the gunshot. I think that Rags knew that it was Mike's intent to leave him. I took Rags home with me. And I had everything that Mike had here. I knew what he was feeding him. I knew, I had known Rags for a long time. And Rags trusted me. And again, it was an honor that Mike trusted me with rags. So, the evening progressed. Sheriffs came and went, coroner came and went. They sent somebody out to pick up some Mike body. That was the last thing that happened. The coroner investigator, again, the Napa County personnel was very gracious. They were all very gracious. They said I could leave. I chose to stay. So it was pretty late at night. It was the night before the blood moon, before the eclipse of the moon. So it was almost a full moon. And it was pretty eerie. Put it this way. I thought it would be eerie. They came, took Mike's body. Everybody left. I was left alone on the property. The moon is up over the building in the sky. And there was just a sense of peace. There was a sense of departure and a sense of peace. The sheriff did identify the body for the coroner at the point when the sheriff was here. I did go over and take a good long look at Mike's body. It was Mike. It was apparent Mike had done it himself. It was a weapon that I had seen in Mike's possession. They took the weapon. The sheriff took all the physical evidence from the scene. They took the suicide notes. They took the weapon. I know they did ballistics. I know they looked for powder burns. They looked for powder burns on Mike's hands. They looked on powder burns around the entry wound. They took a lot of measurements. They took a lot of photographs. I did not take any photographs. But they, you know, you can see that there are a few other trailers around the property. And while there was no one else in the property, once there was enough law enforcement here, they did go inside every one of these and look around. They looked for other tire tracks. You know, they did their job. They did a thorough assessment of the property and the surrounding areas and everything to ascertain that there was no one else here. And I can tell you, there was no one else here. We're out a few miles from the little town of Calistoga. It's very quiet out here. A couple of houses on the front of the property where other people lived. There was nobody else here. Nobody made Mike do this. Nobody came on the property and did it to Mike. Mike saw a window of opportunity when there was nobody here. He did a show that Sunday night. A lot of you listened to it. He talked to Carolyn Baker. He had talked to Jesse Ray that day. He had talked to a number of people, and it was just his window of opportunity. And he was very resolved about it. The timeline seems to be that he had everything all squared away. He did the show. He sent the email to me. It took him just a few minutes to, I would say that 40, 45 minutes between the end of the show and his last email was the time that he spent with Rags. And then he walked out here with great resolve. I could go into the more details. The police, he had a .45 caliber semi-automatic handgun. And the police said that he had two bullets in the gun when he came out here. He had one in the chamber and he had one in the clip. So when he fired the gun, one shell was ejected, the shell that was in the clip, the bullet that was in the clip, then was in the chamber. They found him with a live shell in the chamber. He accomplished his mission with the first bullet. It was quick. It was thorough. It was complete. And he was gone. A friend and acquaintance of his, I won't share any other names, but a fellow steeped in Native American culture, came down here within a day or so after that. And he took me and we went to the spike, the place of Mike's passing, and we did a Native American tobacco ritual to release any remnants of Mike's spirit that were left at the place of his physical passing, to release them. Mike's cremation was yesterday. I went to attend that with Wes, who's being remarkably quiet behind the camera here, and Jesse Ray, and at Wes's request, he did view Mike's body, and it was Mike, and we committed his body. His note to me, he said, return my body to Mother, and I know that by that he meant Mother Earth. So we have his ashes, and they're going to go to a few different places, places that were beloved by Mike and important to Mike. And they will go to some people to whom Mike was important. And that's what I know about the immediate circumstances leading up to Mike's suicide.
We're standing right on the ground.
And we are standing on the ground. This, there were some, you know, Mike had spilled some of himself upon the ground. And before I brought rags back, I just covered the area. Mostly for rags, who amazingly bonded instantly with Jesse Ray. Rags, I thought rags would come over to this spot. You know, again, those of you who were concerned and had expressed the idea that I should make sure that rags got to see Mike's body. Mike did better than that. Mike sat with rags, and rags never even walked over here. I know that he would have a sense, through his sense of smell, of knowing what happened here. This was, Rags wasn't concerned here. Rags immediately bonded with Jesse Ray, and was very comfortable with that. You know, Wes, why don't you, this was the view that Mike had out his trailer, and he was, and he felt blessed to be here. He talked about that these were, you know, he was looking at mountains of Colorado that were bigger, but they weren't green, they were white, they were snow-covered, they were freezing cold and hostile and isolated. And he was very happy to be here. Green, warm, hospitable, comfortable.
You've said a lot, Jack. Do you have any other closing thoughts or comments or anything else you'd like to say?
I was appreciative of Mike's work to an infinite extent. His work changed my life, gave me an awareness that I would not have otherwise had. His choice to let me into his inner circle and be his friend was an honor. The circumstances of his passing have been a gift to me, in that I have gotten to spend time with other people from Mike's inner circle who share my worldview, of which there are remarkably few. So I'm honored. I'll miss him. But I know that he did what he needed to do. I know he was comfortable in doing it. And so bye-bye, Mike.
Thanks, Jack.
And thank you.
Thank you, Jack. Wes.